Beginning for interrupting you, my name is Peter Westmacott, and I'm the British Ambassador here. I'm the guy looking after it in this nice house. And my role is really to say to you all, welcome and thank you so much for coming here to celebrate just a tiny wee bit in advance of St. David's Day. Thank you all for the support in lots of different ways that you are showing to the cause of Wales. Thanks to all those of you who helped put the team together, and the warmest possible welcome to First Minister Carver Jones, who's going to speak in a few moments. I really have a very, very brief warm-up act. They tell me that there is a Welsh proverb that there's a shortage of words. I doubt if it's true. They just gave me that to say it, so I kept very quiet and did not speak for very long. We here at the British Embassy are extremely proud of the fact that we represent the whole of the Union of the United Kingdom. We hope that our Scottish friends will allow us to continue that for many years to come. That's what I'd like to say, as I've said anyway. But tonight we celebrate Wales, St. David's Day, and the extraordinarily important and very warm Welsh community here in the United States. And we're thrilled to be doing that. When I was doing my last job, which was British Ambassador of France, you see I have real hardship jobs. We used to have something called the Six Nations Rugby Tournament, which some of you would have heard of, which was a wonderful opportunity to bring together lots of friends from France and Wales and the other Six Nations. And we had wonderful cheeses and all sorts of other things we're not allowed to import yet in America from Wales. And a whole bunch of other bits of Welsh whiskey and that which we celebrated. But here, we have to focus on St. David's Day caucuses and one or two other things. And I want to say, if I may, how thrilled we all are that yesterday the Welsh caucus on Capitol Hill was inaugurated by the First Minister, but with no less than 12 members of the House of Representatives joining him. So I think it's a great start, and thank you so much to members of Congress who are here this evening to be part of our celebration on behalf of Wales. It's hugely important, and we're very lucky. And happy St. David's Day, 3 or 4 days in advance for Saturday to you all. In addition to the politics, the celebration of the St. David's Day, there's lots of other things to celebrate. We're not quite there where the Irish have got to, where I think every single American claims to have Irish descent. 24 hours just on a green tie. But there are nevertheless 10 million Americans of Welsh origin, which I think is an extraordinary number. And that's an indication of the importance of what we've done in establishing the caucus and the importance of the Welsh community here. The caucus is up and running. St. David's Day is coming in a few days' time. In other respects, there's lots of ways in which food and drink from Wales are things to celebrate. First Minister teased me by saying I was drinking Welsh wine, but I wasn't. but I might be drinking Welsh malt whiskey, which is here tonight.
Yeah, sure is.
And which was such a sellout last time we did this party a couple of years back that we brought it back by popular demand. You will also, I hope, taste some Welsh rennet. You won't yet be having Welsh lamb, but we're working on the FDA and others to allow it to be imported to the United States before long. Meanwhile, there are plenty of other things to celebrate about Wales in the business community. I've been up to Broughton in North Wales, where they make wings for Airbus aircraft, which are now being assembled here in Alabama. There is a great deal of financial and other services industries going on, particularly in Cardiff, where there are major United States investments, and we're very proud of that. There are 60,000 university students in Cardiff alone, and Bangor University is rated number one in the United Kingdom for a whole range of R&D in some sectors, which I've forgotten, but which I did write down, so that I didn't forget it. But since I now have, I'll just have to say that Bangor University is number one in the United Kingdom for a number of very, very important R&D sectors. Forgive me, First Minister, for getting detail wrong. My role is just to say lots of important things about Wales. We're so thrilled to have you here. The First Minister will make a serious and important speech about the things that I forgot to say. And the only other thing I want to say is how thrilled we are, in addition to having Carmen Jones here, to have with us Claire Jones, who is going to play the Welsh national instrument, the harp, here for us in a few moments. I'm really, really lucky to have her because for a number of years she was the official harpist of the Prince and Princess of the Prince of Wales and the Duchess of Cornwall, and was also privileged to play at the wedding of Prince William and Kate Middleton, otherwise known now as the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge. She is a very special musician, we're thrilled to have her here, and she's going to play for 8 or 10 minutes or so when the speech is finished or the First Minister has spoken, so I'm going to ask you very kindly, after the First Minister has spoken, not to go back into an extremely noisy party mode, but to remain quiet and respectful while we listen to Claire play her harp.
That's an example of the Welsh language. As you can see, it's not at all related to English. More about that later. But we're here primarily to celebrate St. David's Day. It's Saturday, in fact, the 1st of March, St. David's Day. Alone of England, Scotland, Wales and Ireland, we have a patron saint who is actually from the country. St. George, of course, was either Georgian or Armenian. St. Andrew, of course, was one of the apostles. St. Patrick was Welsh, kidnapped by Irish pirates, and took Christianity and banished the snakes from Ireland, although not from Wales. But nevertheless, we have a very different culture and tradition compared to our neighbours. But nevertheless, we sit within the UK state. When the Romans were on the island of Britain, the people who lived on that island were all Celts, each and every one of them. The language that they spoke became the forerunner of Welsh. So Welsh is effectively a Romanized form of Celtic. When the Romans left, the Anglo-Saxons arrived, and after many, many centuries of battle, took over most of the island. So the Celts were here first, and so too our English friends, could we say, I enjoy my stay on the island. In fact, it came, of course, after the Romans left. But the Anglo-Saxons, as they conquered most of the island, gave the name Wailhas to the people they fought, and that's where we get the modern word Welsh. It means, in Anglo-Saxon, foreign people who once lived under Roman rule, which shows you how succinct Anglo-Saxon was as a language. And so the scene was set for many centuries of warfare. Arthur was a Welsh king. Merlin was Welsh as well, despite what Disney might tell you. You will see that we have a flag that is a red dragon on a green and white background. It means that when you're in school, we have the hardest flag in the world to draw. But it has an impressive history. The standard version of it is that the dragon is in fact something that descended from the Roman standards that the Romans carried as they went through the island of Britain. There is a more romantic story, though, and that is that Merlin, at the time of the battles between the Celts and the Saxons, had a vision. And he saw in the sky a red dragon and a white dragon fighting each other. And the red dragon won. And he said that this was a sign that the Celts would eventually reclaim the rest of the island of Britain, and the Anglo-Saxons would be driven back to Germany. Could I say, Peter, it's not the current policy of the Welsh government. And it is the case that Wales has been legally part of the UK since 1536. Now, of course, we're in a position where the UK is moving towards becoming more of a federal state. We are effectively an autonomous government within the UK, controlling our own lawmaking, for example, health, education, economic development, amongst other things. The UK is made up, as you will know, of four constituent nations. One which is very big, England, Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland, rather smaller. Of course, the one thing you must not do is assume that England is the entire island. That is something, of course, that is guaranteed to impress us Welsh people as much as it impresses people from Toronto to be told they're American. Throughout the 19th century, Wales was the cradle of the Industrial Revolution. Iron making began in the town of Merthyr Tydfil. The coal field in its day was the largest coal field in the world. It employed 1 in 2 of the male population. That's the equivalent of about 40 million, not far off, once you take out those people who are too young or too old, of the present-day American population. The result is that there's not much of a Welsh diaspora compared to the Irish diaspora, because people didn't have to move away from Wales to get work. There were many who came, of course. Many went to Pennsylvania, to the anthracite coalfield of Pennsylvania. Many went to New York. Many went to Oregon. Many followed Brigham Young to Utah, particularly from the town of Merthyr Tydfil. So there are Welsh settlements dotted around the USA with a great Welsh heritage. I mentioned St. David earlier on. One of the tricks that St. David was able to pull off was that he preached at a village called Llandewi Brefi, for those of you who can pronounce it, there's a prize later. And when he preached there, the crowd couldn't hear him, and so the ground rose from underneath him so he could be heard by the throng. If I could pull that off as a politician, then clearly that would be something that would go down very well amongst the electorate. But we are in a position now in Wales where the coal industry has by and large declined. Mining disappeared almost entirely in the 1980s. Our economy now is much more broad-based, whether it's aeronautics, whether it's automotive, whether it's life sciences, defence, construction, tourism. Our economy now is an economy that's very open to new investment, a workforce that's very, very open to new ideas, a skilled workforce, and one that's supported very strongly by our universities and also by our colleges of further education. I know there are many of you here who already have investments in Wales, and maybe those who are looking to invest in Wales in the future. You will always receive the support of the Welsh Government, sometimes financial, of course, and certainly in terms of moral support as you seek to come to Wales and set up a business in Wales. Now, I mentioned the UK was a state of four nations in many ways. At this time of year, as Peter has already mentioned, the Six Nations rugby tournament takes place. For those of you who are unfamiliar with it, it's the premier rugby tournament of the Northern Hemisphere, in effect. I should mention that Wales has won it in the last 2 years. England, Scotland, Wales, Ireland, France and Italy compete for it. Now, whilst we sit quite happily within the UK state, there is no way you'd want to see a British soccer team or a British rugby team, because we enjoy independence in those two sports. A week Sunday, England play Wales. A big game for us. 82,000 people will be there watching it, many millions on TV. It's part of our, certainly very much part of our history to support the Welsh team in sport, particularly in rugby, where we've been historically more successful than in any other sport, mainly because not as many countries play rugby as soccer. Although we did get to the quarterfinal of the World Cup in 1958, when we lost to the Netherlands. Since then, we have been waiting. But could I say, finally, thanks to you all for coming. Some of you I've met before, some of you I met 2 years ago. The launch of the Friends of Wales caucus on Capitol Hill last night was exceptionally important for us. I do hope that we can have a St. David's Day reception every year here in Washington to continue to... Man, there we are. Your money's important. In order to promote Wales in the years to come. Because we know that if people haven't heard of you, then they will not come and visit you or spend money as tourists. If people haven't heard of you, they will not invest in your country. And so we know full well that we have to make sure that we are there promoting Wales as a nation, yes, and as part of the UK and indeed the European Union. We don't have Guinness, like Ireland, so we don't have that kind of icon, although Arthur Guinness himself had a Welsh mother, nor do we have the tradition of tartan in Scotland or of whiskey, although you will see tonight that there is Welsh whiskey on hand. There is a tradition of whiskey distilling in Wales. It by and large disappeared in the 1890s because Wales was too close to the excise officers and also the influence of the non-conformist chapels at that time, if we're honest. About 10 years ago, literally, a group of men sitting in a pub decided they would actually revive the tradition of whiskey distilling, and here it is today, Penderyn whiskey tripling production in the next 2 years just to keep up with demand. A real Welsh success story. Many thanks to you all for listening. And many thanks to you all for attending. I hope to be back here next year and in years to come.